Hey everybody, this is Michael and welcome back to A Month of Horror. That's right, celebrating horror films all the month of October. Well guys, today I want to talk about a film that I actually saw almost a week ago, and that was, of course, Sinister. And you guys, I really meant to do this review way before now. But, you know, in all truth and honesty, I've just been avoiding talking about the film. I saw this one with my better half, and be honest, we didn't like the film. And this was just, I'm just starting to feel like this was just the nail in the coffin with horror movies. I'm just totally disappointed with horror. All summer, I've been wanting to see a decent horror film, and I really haven't seen any. And this was just like the nail in the coffin. This was the one that just finally made me say, fuck it. I don't want to go see any more horror films. As a matter of fact, after this film went off, I told my girlfriend, this is it. We got to stop going to see these horror movies. I said, none of them are any good. The state of horror is in bad shape. I don't know what the problem is, but it seems like no one out there knows how to do a horror film anymore. And you know what really gets me is all the raves this film has got. You know, granted, everybody has their opinion and they have the right to like what they want to like, and that's fine. But I don't understand why this film has gotten so many rave reviews and people saying it's the scariest movie they've ever seen. Because you know, at all, I didn't experience any of that. I was not scared. There was a few attempts at a jump scare with loud noise and sound effects. I wasn't scared at all. My girlfriend wasn't afraid either. But this film, guys, you know, it stars Ethan Hawke, who is an actor that I respect and that I like. I think he's made some good movies, and I think he's overall a really good actor. But, you know, and this is not directed at him because, you know, this is just the way the film was written. Now, the movie has made $21 million. And it cost $3 million, so, you know, do the math. That's a hit. Now, of course, that ain't really a lot of money, I mean, at all. Because, I mean, if you think about it, the way this film is getting critical praise and fans are raving about the film, being spooked out and scared, you would think it would do a lot more business with that. But it hasn't. And I think, you know, I think it's because, you know, overall, I think the general horror public, they're starving for a decent horror film. I think the public is starving. And I think when these films come out, everybody just flocks to them, thinking, oh, this one's going to be good. This one's going to be good. And then, you know, I remember when this film debuted, it got like an 80-something percent on Rotten Tomatoes. And I hadn't checked it in a while, but the last time I checked it was at like a 63. So, you know, I think that the veil has worn off and people are seeing the movie for what it is. And it's not really a good movie. And, you know, you guys know how I feel already about downer endings. And, you know, it's not so much that the ending has to be a downer ending that ruins the movie. Because in this case, it's not even the downer ending that ruined the film. I understand, you know, it's a horror movie. And, you know, we sometimes shouldn't expect a horror movie to end badly. But Jesus Christ, all these horror films today are ending the same way. Does no one have any creative juices inside them to actually put on pen and paper and let these characters live? Do they just all have to take the easy way out and kill them off? That's not the problem I have with the film, guys. The problem I have, you know, I don't rant very much on movies. But this movie, it deserves a rant. But I just don't have the energy to rant. This film has just made me tired. I'm just tired of horror. That's why I avoided talking about it all this time. I'm just tired of discussing bad horror films. I mean, guys, you know, and other than the ending, what this film is just written badly. It's written badly. Ethan Hawke plays a character that you don't really care about. I mean, at least I didn't. And, you know, the reason I didn't care about him is because he put his family in jeopardy for his own selfish reasons. He had two little kids. He had a wife. And he did not do the right thing in the story. He lied to his wife. And he's out for his own personal fame and glory. So he's not a character that you really feel sympathy for. And other than that, you know, while you're watching a film about a character that doesn't give a shit about his own family, and maybe it hits more to home when you're a father or a mother and you think about your kids and what you would do in that place. But, you know, he just ignores the feelings of his own family and the safety of his family and does his own thing. Don't care. But in this movie, guys, Ethan Hawke plays a true crime writer who got a lot of fame for a book he wrote called, I believe it was Kentucky Blood. And he hasn't been able to follow up that success. I mean, it's like the genius who creates Warp Drive. And, you know, that's his biggest creation. Where do you go from there? And he's been racking his brains and racking his creative juices all this time to try to figure out what he can do to top that book. And unfortunately, hasn't been able to. But now he's on to a new story. He's on to a new case. This family was discovered hung at the beginning of the film. They're hung from a tree in the backyard. I think it's, yeah, four people in the family. There's actually five people in the family, but one of the little kids has gone missing. And he's going to write about this story, about this death. So he moves his family into the house that the family that hung themselves died in. And he lies to his wife because she says something like, "Is there anything you need to tell me about this place?" And hey guys, it's been a week ago since I saw this, so I might be remembering some of the things wrong. But he says, "No, there's nothing happened in the house," but which, you know, basically is the truth. It didn't happen in the house; it happened in the backyard. But still, he knew what she was talking about, and he lied to her. And so, you know, the more he investigates, it leads him upstairs to the attic where he finds this box with an old-style 8mm projector in it and, like, four rolls of film. And I think 8mm film. And I think each canister that protects the film is labeled. One, and I might not be getting the names right, guys, but one of the films are labeled Barbecue. Then we have one called Pool Party. Then we have one called Hanging Around. And then we have one called Lawn Care Time or something like that. But he starts watching the tapes, and the Hanging Around tape is actually showing the family that died in this home in the backyard. It's showing them being hung. You can see something slicing the branch off like a saw, but you can't see who's doing it. And the family hangs and dies. He's freaked out about it, and then he watches all the other films, and they all depict this family dying. These separate families, all four of them dying. And he kind of gets obsessive about it and starts watching it. And then after this, he starts hearing things in the house. He gets up in the middle of the night because of sounds he hears. He finds a snake and a scorpion up in the attic, freaks him out. His room where he keeps all of his writings and like a crime scene in his room where he does all his work. He locks it up. Somebody keeps unlocking his room and turning on the projector, so he's really freaking out here. And there's a deputy who's wanting to be acknowledged in his new book and is just going out of his way to help him. And he's giving this deputy all these, he's giving him information that he saw on the film and telling him to check it. Hey, there's a family murdered. Could you find out any information on this family that was murdered in so-and-so and they were burned in a car or they were thrown in a pool and drowned? So the deputy is just eager to help, real eager to help. And back and forth, the deputy comes and exchanges information with him. And then his kids start acting weird. His one son starts having these really bad night terrors and walking in his sleep, ending up outside and stuff. And his daughter is an artist, and she's drawing all these weird figures that she's seeing in her mind. And then she's seeing actual ghosts. And she's drawing it on the walls and kind of freaking out. And the wife is upset, and you know, because she don't think they should be there, that he's getting too obsessed. Okay. What I did like about the film was the cinematography and the musical score, but that's it. I didn't care for the story because Ethan Hawke's character sucks. He is a lousy dad. His son is having all these terrors, and his daughter's freaking out, and he still remains in the house. And another thing, guys, that the movie is really, really bad at. You know, Ethan Hawke's character is really pretty adept on the computer. He can, you know, find out what he needs to find out. He can research things and all this. But why the deputy character? He's not even needed. Because all the shit that Ethan Hawke asked the deputy to find out for him, he could easily find out for himself on his laptop computer. So the deputy character wasn't needed. And you know, the whole thing could have been avoided if the guy would have just stood up for his family and got the hell out of the house. But of course, you know, if you move into it, you know, I know it's a movie. And, you know, people might say, well, just sit back and enjoy the movie. You know, I'm all for that. But I just don't like when I'm insulted while watching a movie. You know, don't play me for a fool. I mean, you know, if you move into a house, you know, I wouldn't move into a house where five people or four people died anyway. I just wouldn't do it. But, of course, when he starts having he starts hearing all these sounds in his house, he starts seeing snakes and scorpions. His kids are freaking out. His wife's upset. There's been four murders in the house. What does it take for you to get the fuck out? And another part of the story, guys, that bothered me was that, you know, he finds this box of all these tapes of people being murdered. And then, you know, he's making notes in his room and he writes, "Who put the box here?" And I'm thinking, duh. Okay, we've got two choices here. Either the person that did the murders filmed it, or either the person had a friend that assisted him did it. And the box was put there by somebody associated with the murder. In either case, the biggest quip I had with the whole film was that, dude, you find these tapes in the attic depicting murders, and you still want to stay in the fucking house? Does it ever occur to you that the murderer might come back to this house to get that? And still the guy doesn't see that as being reason enough to get his family out. I mean, if I move into a house and I know that people died in that house and I find some hard evidence that only the killer could put there, I'm out of there. And then, to tell you how selfish this character is when he even finds this stuff, he still doesn't take it to the police. He just sits there, and how this guy sleeps at night is beyond me. There's no way I could sleep. And another thing about the film, guys, is this guy has woke up four or five times in the middle of the night, and he's walking around with a bat, and he's trying to find out where the noises are coming from, and not once, maybe just once, but out of all these times, he never turns a light on. He's walking in the dark. And I'm looking over at my girlfriend and I'm saying, turn the light on, turn the light on. Why don't he turn the light on? It's night, it's dark. A normal person would turn the light on. So that's what I mean when this film is stupid, guys. It insults you because, for one, if you think somebody is in your house and you're hearing sounds, why would you walk around in the dark? And then it's just like, you know, well, it's written to where we'll write it as being dark in the house to build up some kind of suspense or tension. Not because it's logical to turn on the light, but because we're going to leave the light off so that it just moves the story along. We don't do it for any other reason other than to progress the story. We don't do it because it makes sense. And then, guys, you know, there's one scene in the film where he actually falls, the projector and the film and it all falls to the floor in the hallway. I mean, hits hard. Nobody in the house wakes up. Nobody. Nobody hears it. All the time this guy is walking at night, his wife is never there. She just, this woman sleeps through anything. So guys, I just, the whole time I'm sitting there watching this film, I'm thinking, this is stupid. This is stupid. You know, why are you walking around in the damn dark, dude? You have, this is 2012. Turn the freaking light on. So we have some really dumb characters in this movie. The wife sleeps through everything. Ethan Hawke's character is not redeemable. You don't really care about him. If you really think about it, you know, why would you care about this guy? He put his family in jeopardy. Lied to him. Why would you care about this guy? And then, of course, guys, we learned that by the end of the film, and this is a major spoiler, of course, but it does say massive spoilers, we learned that the whole thing is being caused by a demon that lives in images, pictures, movie pictures, any kind of image. He lives in those images. They act as a doorway to our world. And we learned that this demon has been possessing one of the children in a family and then having that child kill that family, and then he pulls the child into his world and he slowly eats their soul. So I don't know what the deal is with demons in boxes and demons in pictures and what the deal is lately with demons and kids. But everybody's obsessed with doing a demon in a kid movie. So the demon is behind all of this. He's behind all the murders and all the other scenes that he sees on these films. As a matter of fact, he's possessing a kid from every one of those families to do his dirty work. And I really don't understand really what's the point of killing the whole family. If it's ultimately, you know, what all you want is a kid's soul, just take the kid. But in the end, Ethan Hawke finally gets his family out of there and he puts his own selfish needs aside. And you might think, well, you know, he did the right thing in the end. But the problem is, it's too late. The damage has been done. Now, if he'd never moved there to begin with, this never would have happened. But the damage is already done. The demon follows him to his new home. And, you know, it's his old home. And so he goes upstairs and the box is sitting upstairs in his attic. And he's like, what the fuck? And, you know, he can't get rid of these things no matter what. And in the end, we find out that his daughter is possessed by this same demon. And she ends up poisoning the entire family and chopping their heads off and disembodying them. I mean, cuts them all up. And there you have it. Sinister, the scariest film ever made. I wasn't creeped out by the film, guys. You know, one person told me that, you know, well, you know, it's the 8mm stuff. It's really creepy. I don't understand why people are saying the imagery is like the most creepiest and scariest and all this ever seen and all that. I just don't get that because it's not. I mean, if you've watched horror films, you've seen way more disgusting or creepy things. And this is just a movie to me, guys. It just, all the way around, it fails. I'm really, really leery about seeing any more damn horror films. I'm tired of the state of horror. Horror is in bad shape. Horror is drowning. And all these films that are coming out and all these films that are getting supported by people because, you know, there's no more horror for them to see. So they're going to go see it. Stop watching it. Stop watching it. Don't support it. I mean, you know, maybe they'll get off their asses and actually put some creativity in their movies. But, guys, I didn't like this film. I just did not like this movie. Anyway, that's my thought on Sinister. If you like the film, fine, enjoy it. But I just didn't find anything to like in this movie. Thanks for watching, everybody. Take care, and I'll see you at the next Month of Horror movie review.